Looking for the king of podcasts? You're at the wrong channel. Looking for good ideas for life? You are far from good hands. If you think the listener is always right, you are far from the right place. Hosted by a Northeasterner by birth, a rebel by choice. If you want a host that floats between love and madness, then play on and listen to Crazy Train Radio.
What up, Crazy Train Radio?
You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
I love scotch. I love scotch. Scotch is scotch, scotch. Here it goes down, down into my belly.
Don't mess with me, I'm one crazy mofo.
This brand is truly exciting, and I'm so glad that they are starting to make a positive impact. Little Bean Soapery is a woman-owned small business based in Northeast Pennsylvania. Little Bean Soapery does so much, as all products are handcrafted and offer many different things for both men and women. Soaps, scrubs, body butters, bath bombs, solid cologne, and much more. Little Bean Soapery also does things for special occasions such as birthdays, Mother's Day, Father's Day, and special seasonal gift sets. But also, let's not forget large orders for party favors by request. The great things about all products is that they are crafted to be nourishing on the skin. If you wish to check them out, please feel free to visit littlebeansoapery.com. Any questions, please feel free to also email littlebeansoapery@gmail.com for custom inquiries and or ask anything else you wish. Tell them that Elena from Crazy Train Radio sent ya.
Hi, this welcome to Crazy Train Radio. I'm David Morrell, author of First Blood and Brotherhood of the Rose. I hope you enjoy the conversations here.
Hey folks, it's your least favorite host in a podcast world, Croc, Jonathan Steele.
And I'm Elena, your favorite host from the Emerald Isle.
Boy, do we have a good one for you today.
This Canadian-American novelist is probably best known for his debut novel, First Blood, that was later adapted as part of the 1982 film of the same name, which went on to spawn the successful Rambo franchise starring Sylvester Stallone. However, it should be noted, this man has had a successful writing career on top of some other stuff I read, which we know everything on the internet is true, because he has written 28 novels. I know when I reached out initially last summer, he was in prep work for something else. and his work has been translated into over 30 different languages. This guest, author David Morrell. Good morning, David. How are you?
Good morning. We're fine. Thank you.
That's good to hear. So let me start there with works being translated into over 30 different languages. And we'll get into it, but I know you have a background in English as far as your degree. You were a professor and such. With some of your stuff being translated, and I don't know your expertise in other languages, has there been any miscommunication in terms of the story you put down in paper as far as the books that have been released just because of translation issues?
Well, there's no way for me to tell. There's so many different publishers. Anecdotally, I have been told that, I don't know if this still persists, but there was a time when Russian translations of my work, particularly First Blood, were altered. Portions were cut out, or portions were emphasized. And I'm assuming this was for whatever political reason a Russian publisher would have against, say, the United States. There's an interesting history here. In the day when the Soviet Union collapsed at an early 1990s, there was a rush from Russian publishers to make American works available. And publishers wouldn't, authors wouldn't trust the Russians. What were they going to pay in ruples through a bank account? It was very unclear whether the remuneration for the book would in fact materialize. So Russian representatives would go to New York and have meetings with agents representing publishers with paper bags of cash, and that they would then offer, here we go, here's the advance for the translation, and they would give the agent this big wad of dollar bills, or not dollar bills, but what have you, which, you know, looks suspiciously like a drug deal. And at one point, someone in the business, I want to make this very vague, asked, since it was cash, why didn't they just hide it and I wouldn't pay taxes on it? And I said, that's the craziest idea anybody ever recently made to me, because there's no way I'm going to go to jail for the amount of money that the Russians were willing to pay, which wasn't a lot for a translation. So it's interesting how times change.
And, you know, that's an interesting thing there, and we don't have to get into specifics. But on the business side of things, and obviously you have agents and lawyers and all involved with that, but just the way I took it from that answer is, is there not a standard fee, per se, that they would pay? Like, say I wanted to take one of your books and publish it in, say, French Canadian, because I know you're, like I said, you're from Ontario. Whatever I want to translate it to sell your product, there's not a standard fee. Okay, David is expecting, I'm just going to throw a number out here, $100,000 for the rights to his book. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's not a standard.
Now, everything's a negotiation. A publisher, a foreign publisher, comes to an agent with an offer. And it varies. I'm very popular in Poland, for example. So my prices there are somewhat higher than they would be in France. Although they read me in France too, but Poland has been from the start very, very loyal. My agent, my foreign agent, would expect that the offer there would be higher than I would get from other countries. And then we can either say, yeah, that's a reasonable offer because they're advances. So the money I receive for a book counts against sales. So the sales then have to reach an amount equal in terms of my royalties to the advance I'm paid before I'll get any more money. So, and publishing is a very narrow industry. So if I don't, and just to use author speak, if I don't earn out my advance, if the publisher is in the negative column for a book that I authored, allowed them for a fee to publish, then the next time I'm offered something, the price will automatically be lower, because then they'll go down below whatever I earned out on. So advances are simply a good faith gesture toward what they think the book will do. And they vary from country to country. And these days, unless you're John Grisham or Stephen King, no one is paying $100,000 for a foreign translation. Those days are long gone. The foreign translation market has narrowed considerably, just as the market in the United States for certain kinds of books has narrowed. These days, brand name books, books with social issues, and books either written by women or featuring women, all main characters, are predominantly what drives the market.
Interesting. And we can talk the business side of things all day, but that's not why I have you here today.
Well, I get seldom asked that kind of question. So it's for me interesting how things work. Methods are very interesting to me. And I know that for a lot of people, the whole publishing world is like, how does that work? So I enjoy talking about that kind of thing.
Yeah. And the reason I asked it, and I appreciate you answering it to what we can, because I'm not the IRS. I don't care if you get $100,000, $100 million, whatever the case is for your advances. That's not my business, but I appreciate you answering it. The reason I asked it was I find it interesting that when people look at, oh, well, all authors or screenwriters or this or that or multimillionaires and whatever the case may be, they don't truly understand the behind the scenes side of things that you just explained there about the negotiations, right, and everything else. But like I said in the intro there, when I initially reached out to you through email and such last, I believe it was August, you were, and David was awesome with his response. Not only was he quick, but he was like, hey, this is what's going on. You were doing research and starting to do some prep work for a new project. Have you announced that new project, and can you talk about that right now?
Yeah, I'm writing a Western that's could be called a Western about Westerns, or a novel about the American West. My goal is to see if I can write a Western that doesn't feel like a genre book, but has the excitement we associate with a Western. Very difficult project. I think the Western is probably the most difficult genre to work in, because there are so many, to use author speak, so many tropes that we're familiar with, such as the ties walking down the street and fast drawing on each other. And readers or viewers sort of expect it, but my God, that's a cliche. So how do you create the same kind of excitement, but use a parallel situation? And I've been working on the book for 2 years. As I just described, the current market favors three categories, and it certainly doesn't favor Westerns. So at the moment, I'm writing the book for myself, which is what I've always done anyhow. I've never, with a few exceptions, I've never submitted an outline. I've always written the book and sent it in and say, publish it or don't publish it, but this is the book I want it to write. I mean, there are editing and all that. But in terms of the overall concept, it's what I'm, you know, you think about a book taking a year of your life, by God, you better believe in it. And if you're writing it to fulfill what you think would be money you earn in a current market, that changes so fast. I have two mantras as a writer. One is be a first rate version of yourself. And the other is don't chase the market. You'll always see its backside. So I'm, you know, basically writing the book for myself. I'm working every day, and I might be able to finish it next year. It's really hard to say until whatever's going on in the current market rotate so that this kind of book would be available again.
Interesting. Now, as far as doing research, because obviously you want to try to, and most authors I have spoken with want to try to be as accurate, whether it be historically or whatever the topic is, correct as possible in telling their story. Now, do you find with yourself, as far as when you're trying to do your homework and putting together your story, as far as the research side of things goes, do you find yourself that you are, or I should say, not that you are, but that you could end up going down a deep rabbit hole as far as you start looking at one thing? And I was a history major in school. But it's like you start looking at one particular thing in the topic you're looking at, then as you're reading stuff and trying to confirm it through other sources, you find yourself, well, there's three other directions I can go here. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Another mantra that sometimes you hear fiction teachers saying, or editors or whatever, saying, write what you know about. Well, my mantra in that case is write what I want to know about. So I often, for choosing a project that I'm willing to spend a year or more on, and I'm talking about writing every day, often it's because the subject interests me and I don't know anything about it and I want to know more. So I love the research, and history is important to me. I've written some historical novels. I've written some set in the modern world. The goal is to serve the story. So if I'm working, let's say I were to write a medical story, which is, you know, would be very difficult for me. I think it would be worth my while to make contact with physicians in the specialty that I'm writing about, and to ask them if I could interview them, or even in a remote way, see how their day works, so that I'm writing about what they do with some degree of knowledge. And most people, or most professionals in various ways, are more than happy to respond to that, because they see how poorly misinformed writers of many, not all, I don't, but let's say you're watching television. In most cases, medical shows are ludicrous. In most cases, legal shows are ludicrous. We see trials in which the defense attorney or the prosecutor walks right up to the witness stand and practically leans over into the witness box. If someone did that in real life, they'd go to jail. It would be contempt at least. So I tell writers, dig into the world you want to write about so you learn its vocabulary. And it only makes sense that that you would try to get those details right. There is a point where you have to say to yourself, if I'm ever going to write the book, I have to stop. My favorite illustration of this is I wrote three novels that are set in 1854, 1855 London. They're thrillers. They're gothic and filled with action and filled with the sort of thing that I'm known for, say, in my spy novels. And Queen Victoria appears in those books. And I needed to find a short form to describe her bearing. And I was reading book after book after book about her. And I mean, I don't want to go into, in the book, in my novel, a ton of detail, but I just want to give the sense quickly of who she is. And I found this detail in like the fifth book I read about Queen Victoria, that her mother was very strict when Victoria was little, let's say 4 or 5 years old. Her mother took holly, the leaves of a holly branch are extremely sharp edged. very, they can stab you. And certainly you would not want leaves of that under your collar. But Victoria's mother put leaves from a holly plant under Victoria's collar, and they would sting her only if she slouched. So that if she stood absolutely with regal bearing, she would not be in pain. And that was the detail that I used to describe Victoria walking into a room. And it's very vivid. It brings in her youth. And it and at the same time, it's tactile, because we can feel the imagined pain that Victoria would have felt if she hadn't been very erect in her stature. So at a certain point, that's what I look for, those details that are kind of short form for a lot of larger things.
And I want to mention this as far as the research for more modern times as well. And David's book, I should say, The Shimmer, from 2009, he actually went out and actually earned his FAA license to pilot his own small plane. So this is how much detail he goes into to learn subjects.
I had to do it because The Shimmer is about real life mysterious lights in a section of Texas that's associated with a town called Marfa. And Marfa, the film buffs will remember Marfa perhaps because the film Giant with James Dean, Rock Hudson, and Elizabeth Taylor was filmed around Marfa. But Marfa's other fame is that at night, around 9:30, just after dark, mysterious lights appear in the sky, and they grow, they shrink, they change colors, they blend, they hover. It's really quite a show. It's probably ball lightning, heat lightning, something like that. But boy, is it mysterious. In the Second World War, there was a air base there, people being trained to go to the war. And they used single-engine prop planes and used the lights as part of the training exercise so that the airplanes would fly toward where the lights were, and they had paper sacks of flour, and they would drop, you can, on these planes, you can open a window, and they would drop the paper sacks, and in the day they come to see where the flour landed, and the splotches of white, and try to figure out, you know, whether there was, were these UFOs, what on earth was going on out here. Well, I knew I needed that in the story, so I saw no other alternative than at least to have some experience in a private plane, such as being at least in the passenger seat. But the more I thought about it, the more I thought I might as well get the training. And it's a classic example of how research can make a person fuller by writing a book. So yes, I received my private pilot's license.
Well, the other thing as far as research goes, I found interesting. And again, I don't think I've ever dropped this name on this particular show, but I guess it goes into my history background as well. But you actually, in the 80s, if I read that correctly, got some training with G. Gordon Liddy, who is known for Watergate and such, but he had his own private investigation and corporate security schooling. So what was it about going to learn from Mr. Liddy?
Well, he was seldom there. He lent his name. The school, the academy, as it was called, the G. Gordon Liddy Academy of Corporate Security and Private Investigation, was taught only three times. It was 3 weeks, morning, noon, a day and night, 7 days a week. And it was taught three times, and then for various reasons, it was no longer continued. I heard about it and got in touch with the people who were putting it together. This was in 1986, $3,600, which I have no idea what the comparable fee would be now. And that didn't include the airfare to get there, didn't include 3 weeks of hotel bills. It did not include 3 weeks of food. And the course was constructed with 3 days per expertise. And the instructors were former CIA, FBI, DEA, et cetera, former Mossad, and U.S. Marshal, former U.S. Marshal. That man had been part of the detail that had been in charge of protecting John Hinckley after he shot President Reagan. And so for 3 weeks, every 3 days, I learned all kinds of things that I've used in my novels and continued my relationship with many of the instructors. And Gordon would show up on the weekends to give a talk and answer questions. I went to dinner with him on several occasions. And this is Gordon was interesting because he was not in person the person that people heard on his radio show or heard in public interviews. Gordon was extremely cultured. Much of our dinner conversation was about opera. And I did not find him to be, for the most part at all, as people think of G. Gordon Liddy. He had a persona, and he was true to it in public. I liked Gordon a lot, and he was a pretty good writer. He wrote a couple of novels, and he wrote a autobiography, which is pretty interesting as well.
Well, I mentioned also during the introduction that you had done some other things, and I know you had taught at the University of Iowa, if I got that correctly.
And yes, that's correct.
Yes, you had, or you have a background in English. You obviously did your master's talking about Hemingway style, and you actually went to Penn State to learn some things based on Hemingway scholar Phillip Young. And what was it about Hemingway that really struck a chord for you?
Well, we have to go back in time. Hemingway committed suicide. It's been a while since I looked at the data, 61, I believe. And I was very young. I was in high school, but I became very interested in him because I never heard of him. And I began reading him. And when I was in college, my BA is from a small college, now a university in Southern Ontario called at that time it was St. Jerome's College, but now it's St. Jerome's University, affiliated with the University of Waterloo. And they had a small library with a obviously limited amount of books. But one day in my early fourth year, I asked if they had a book about Hemingway, and they showed me a book, a very small book, the first book that had been published about Hemingway by Phillip Young. And Young wrote so wonderfully about literature, so conversationally and at the same time so profoundly about literature, that I was determined to meet him and study with him. So my wife, we'd been married a year. She was pregnant. She taught high school history. And I went home and I said to her, we're in a small apartment, I said, you know, I read this guy, Phillip Young. What would you think if after the baby comes, you quit your job and we go to the United States? And if I can, I'll study with Phillip Young. And my wife, who is as adventurous as I am about finding our way in life, said, sure, let's go. And so eventually I was at Penn State. I became friends with Phillip Young. I became his graduate assistant. And after his wife died, my wife became his, for lack of a better word, housekeeper. She took care of, he had no one there. He had a young child. So we, in a sense, lived there. Well, we didn't sleep there, but for a year I ate dinner every night with Phillip Young. There are few instances where a graduate student and a professor were that close. I did my master's thesis with Phillip Young on Hemingway's style, and that my learning about style in that way, a very disciplined way, was helpful when, as I pursued my own career as an author. I don't write like Hemingway, but I learned things from Hemingway that I could adapt for my own techniques.
And obviously, like you said, you ended up coming to the States and studying with Phillip and ended up getting your citizenship in the early 90s, if I read that correctly. So with all that being said, I should say, what was it about the New Mexico area to say where you could have gone wherever in this country? What was it about New Mexico that said, you know, this is where I would like to go for my family and everything else?
We had been in Southern Ontario. We lived in Central Pennsylvania. Lovely. They call it Happy Valley in the area where State College. It's a really a lovely area. And then we'd moved to Iowa, which is lovely in a different way. It doesn't have many mountains, but we really enjoyed Iowa a lot. And however, in 1987, our 15-year-old son Matthew died from a rare bone cancer called Ewing sarcoma. And we stayed there in shock for a time. By then, I had resigned my professorship. And we stayed there in shock. The numbness is overwhelming. I've written a lot about grief, especially for grief for a child. And in 1992, we realized that our son, if he had lived, would have been long gone. He'd have been out of high school. He'd be in college, and he would have been on with his life. And my wife said, I like to quote my wife a lot. She said, it's time for us to begin act three. And so we looked around for somewhere else to live, to further that attempt to make ourselves fuller, which is the whole point of my books. And there weren't a lot of choices. If you live in Iowa or Pennsylvania, heavily wooded sections, you know, you can go to the seacoast or you can go to the mountains of the West. And we had chance to watch a television show called This Old House, a PBS show in which the people involved would go from city to city and renovate a classic house typical of the architecture of the region. And we watched, I knew nothing about Adobe Pueblo houses and the distinctive architecture that's in the northern part of New Mexico. I had no idea. I thought Santa Fe was like Phoenix. A low desert and very flat. Well, there are mountains near Phoenix, but I had no idea Santa Fe was in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains at 7,000 feet. And we came to Santa Fe for my birthday just to look around, and we took to it so swiftly. This is a pattern in our lives that on July 5, we were living here. And they call it, obviously every area has its own appeal. I'm not suggesting where we are is any better than anywhere else, but it suits us to be near the mountains at an altitude of 7,000 feet where the air is very clear and where many, many, many Westerns have been filmed. And we just felt as if reincarnation were a real thing. We felt as if we had found the place we were meant to be.
And that's the key, that everybody's going to go with what works for them, whether it's a living situation, work situation, and whatever angle you want to wish or look at. But you mentioned your son Matthew there with the Ewing's sarcoma. Now, I had seen and read that you had a granddaughter that had the same disease or
Yes.
Same form of cancer.
Yes.
And obviously I'd be curious, you know, as a cancer survivor myself, was that something that was, is that a genetic type of disease in terms of that runs in families and such?
Until recently, not a lot of was known about Ewing's. When Matt had the disease and didn't survive, it was basically a category. And these days, it's in. It might have changed since Natalie's illness, but there were four categories of the disease, and it's very rare in the United States. Per year, there might be only 250 people who come down with the disease. There's so little research been done on it that there's no way for us to find out whether this is an inherited disease. We were told by several specialists that it was not inherited, that in the families that they have studied where Ewing's occurred, it was exceedingly rare for another person in the descendant part of the family to come to have the disease. Matt's disease, the tumors grew in his ribs. In Natalie's case, they grew in her hips. And we're very connected with research in the disease. When Matt went through chemotherapy, various protocols were introduced that were used for the first time on him. And they discovered that some had a quick effect, but not a lasting effect. So that in 2 weeks, a tumor would shrink remarkably. But if the same chemotherapy were then used again, the tumor would come back. So that there had to be, you'd use that for 2 weeks and use something else for 2 weeks and use something else for 2 weeks. Ewing's is a very aggressive cancer. And when Natalie was being treated, by God, some of the protocol was what had Matt had. She died, God bless her, in 2009. Matt died in 1987. Some of that protocol was still being used. And we have a fund at the University of Iowa hospitals and clinics, the Matt Morrell and Natalie Sanchez Children's Cancer Research Fund, in which we've been able to channel a lot of money in various ways to it. And one of the things they do in the studies is they're trying to find a way, because chemotherapy, it makes you sick. Mm-hmm. And if they can find a way to reduce the nausea, then perhaps the patient could receive a stronger, more effective a dose of the chemotherapy. So there's we're helping fund some research into how to reduce nausea in chemotherapy for children. It's and I've done a lot. I give talks to grief groups, and I've written about grief both in nonfiction and in fiction. And it's a topic that I'm very very concerned about. And I just found out this is, to me, is inspiring. I found out that there are camps in the summer for children who have lost parents or lost brothers and sisters or close friends, where children in grief, only children in grief, can go to these camps and have, because it's very, I mean, it's so crushing, the emotions, and have the experience of freedom with other people, understand what it's like, and then have periodically sessions where they talk about how they're feeling. And I got very excited when I heard about this, and we recently donated a fairly large amount of money to the organization to help fund it. And my 18-year-old granddaughter, who has had that experience firsthand, is thinking about maybe she'll be a counselor at one of these camps. So I was very excited when I heard about this.
Yeah, I actually like that concept, that especially when you're dealing with kids, you know, there's times that as adults we have trouble in certain aspects processing things with all that going on. So I actually really appreciate that concept that they have these camps and stuff that kids can go and feel their way out, I guess is the best way to say. with people with similar circumstances.
It's, yes. The key, if you have someone you profoundly loved who dies, your grief is for life. Yeah. When I hear this business about closure, and I it makes me upset, because my son died in 87. I think of him every day. I think of Natalie every day. And there is no closure. What there is adaptation and perhaps modifying your life so that you can help other people in pain.
Yeah.
Just to go back to what I was saying about the camps, anybody interested, they're called camps experience. If someone's interested in this camps experience, you can Google that and learn more about the organization.
And I hope it's okay to mention it here, because you've talked about speaking about grief, and you have background training in this as well, not only from personal experience, but you've learned as well. If people would like to reach out, davidmorrell.net, I'm sure you can point them in directions as well, whether it be these camps or just from stuff you had learned over time.
I have a book called Fireflies in which I talk about a lot about this. People who have lost children, either grandparents, parents, or siblings who have lost people close to them die, there is an organization called the Compassionate Friends, which is very helpful to my wife and I. It's the largest grief group in the world. The Compassionate Friends, and they have in many cities places, groups where you can, participate. It's something that people don't talk about, particularly men. They tend to say, "Oh, I can handle this," and then they start, hitting the drugs and hitting the booze, and the marriages fail and all that, because people won't talk and admit that this is hard. Women, I've found in my experience, handle grief a lot better than men do. Because in the United States, at least, you're not supposed to show emotion. And that's one reason why I created Rambo and why I talk so much about grief, and particularly panic attacks. Whenever I give talks to grief groups, the largest group I ever addressed was 2,000 weeping parents. That was an experience. And I always, the way these things work is you have to establish your credentials. So I tell the story about Matt and Natalie in a short way. And then I say, I know what I'm talking about when I speak to you. And then I always say, so how are the panic attacks going? And people who are weeping are suddenly laughing because they know what I'm talking about, that panic attacks are the great burden of people in grief. And nobody wants to talk about them because they feel so helpless, they're embarrassed. It's a big topic. And I in some ways, that's what I took away from my experience, is to try to talk about this in an open way so that people would feel better able. I find if you say talk about something, that you can handle it better.
And the thing I want to take away from this part here, folks, is that whether it is you dealt with illness or loss of a children or child and or grandchild like David, or whatever the case is, or sibling, or whatever the situation, because everybody's situation is different.
Exactly.
Please don't hesitate to reach out for help if you think you need it. There's nothing wrong for reaching out for a hand. There are organizations, there are different ways that folks can address, whether it's the panic attacks, as David says, or grief, or whatever the case may be, there is help out there. And I hope people are willing to address it, which I think it's a big thing for mental health there, that people are starting to look at it and address it. But like David said, that there's not as much or not many people addressing it, especially in the States, because of that fear. But I hope people will not be afraid to reach out, because it's okay.
Well, if you're married and you want to save your marriage, by God, you better address the issue, because people grieve it different. The number of divorces I've seen because of grief, because people grieve in different ways at different times, and they don't talk about it, and they won't give each other the room. It's a sad series of events I've seen. So,
well, folks, it's okay to address these, not only for yourself, but for your relationships as well. But you mentioned a name there, Rambo, as part of your the story you told as far as grief and just everything that goes with it. When you wrote the novel in 72, or released it, I should say, did you ever expect it to be what it has become?
It would have been impossible to expect anything. The market in those days, what I wanted to do was find a new way to write action based upon my Hemingway research, and at the same time address what I thought was a near civil war that was occurring in the United States at that time, because partly because of the Vietnam War and partly because of civil rights. And First Blood, the novel, is basically an allegory about two sides that don't want to understand each other and lead to catastrophe, with the system, Colonel Troutman, the system finally destroys Rambo at the end of the novel. And there was at that time, in terms of what we call a non-pulp book, one that actually tried to be a novel, First Blood probably had more action than any other novel written in English to that time. And my agent said, you know, there's the market for action books. You know, it's paperback, and this is a whole different, more serious book. He said, I might be able to get you a paperback sale, but we'll see. And it turned out that within 6 weeks, he was able to sell it as a hardback, and came at the right time. I'm saying that in a strange way in history, where in 1972, the book had been published in 68, it might've disappeared. It might've been rejected. But by 72, the kinds of issues that I address in First Blood to do with different attitudes toward what the United States is, they were ready to be discussed. So a first novel normally disappears, but this novel attracted an unusual amount of attention. It was reviewed in every major place that a book could be reviewed. And it had a really good paperback sale. It had a movie sale all right away. And that's exceedingly unusual. And but then it took 10 years for the movie to get made, and things take their own time. When Edgar Rice Burroughs was writing Tarzan, he had no idea what would happen. When Ian Fleming was writing James Bond, he had no way to tell what was happening. And those early books in both cases were modest successes. It's interesting to me, Rambo is frequently linked in this way, that from novels into movies and then into international recognition, there were five big names in the 20th century, and they would be Sherlock Holmes, Tarzan, James Bond, Rambo, and Harry Potter. And in every case, those authors had no way to imagine what was going to happen with those characters. And I often, when I sign a book for somebody, I say best wishes from Rambo's father. Because I think of myself as Rambo as being a child who grew up and went his own way. And I'm, related in the same way that a parent is related to a child who grew up. And it's interesting to me the different directions the character took.
Well, obviously it's its own beast in terms of taking a novel into a script. And obviously we're talking almost 40 years at this point of the Rambo character and such. How much involvement did you have with the rest of the series? And also in terms of converting, especially with the first one, converting a script from your novel?
Well, it's very seldom that the author of a novel is asked to participate in the movie making process. The only two that I think of automatically who had great careers, both as novelists and screenwriters, are Michael Crichton, and particularly William Goldman, who received several Academy Awards for being for adapting his novels and other novels. To answer the question, I had nothing to do with the adaptation of First Blood, but I had a good relationship with the producers, and they would call me on occasion. There were two producers, Mario Kassar and Andrew Vanya. One was Lebanese, the other was Hungarian. I knew Mario sort of. We talked and all, but I talked more to Andy. And Andy, I remember, called — this was astonishing — that a producer would call the author. I mean, utterly, utterly unbelievable that the producer would call the author for advice. And the advice was, your novel is set in Kentucky. We're thinking of moving it to the Pacific Northwest because we can get better financing there. So is there a reason why the story won't work if we translate it to the Pacific Northwest? Now, this is a really smart guy. This is so unusually smart for people in the movie business. I said, no, there's no reason at all why you can't do that. Go ahead. And he said, thank you. And they eventually filmed it in British Columbia, in which the American Northwest was seemingly portrayed. I had more to do with the later films, 2 and 3, because I wrote novelizations for them as an experiment, and also because the shooting scripts for 2 and 3 were pretty thin. For example, in Rambo 2, he goes back to Vietnam to the prisoner of war camp from which he escaped. And this is mentioned in the film, but by God, he could be going anywhere. There is no reaction whatsoever to him going back to where he was held prisoner. And it seemed to me that this isn't true to the character. And when I was asked to do a novelization for the second film, that was one thing that I emphasized intensely, that he was going back. He knew the territory, but more than that, he had to — tough guy that he is — he had to overcome some serious psychological revulsion to returning to where he had been tortured. And there were other things that I added to the mythology, so to speak, in 2 and 3. And when I did the novelization for 3, the scripts were still in process, and there were some elements from the novelization that wound up being in the film. By then I was having more conversations with Andy, and we often talked about the character. And my contribution was minor. I'm not suggesting that I was any way definitive, but I, in a tangential way, I had something to do, which is with the development of the character in films, which is not common.
And I appreciate to hear that there was a certain amount of respect for them to call you.
And they were classy guys. They understood that, and for a time their company, Carolco, was the most dynamic company in Hollywood. And they understood that treating talent well is the way you make exciting pictures. And by contrast, I haven't had many movies made. I had the First Blood franchise, and I had a book of mine called The Brotherhood of the Rose, which was turned into an NBC miniseries, which is the only, to this day, the only miniseries ever aired after a Super Bowl. So people say, well, it's too bad, you know, there weren't more. And, you know, the fact is, of those 28 novels, 25 of them have been optioned. Several were sold. Michael Douglas outright paid a considerable amount of money for a book of mine called Extreme Denial and then did nothing with it. And the process of taking a book and adapting it into movies is so complicated, involving so many people, that it's a miracle they ever get made. I once had the head of a studio who wrote the script for a book of mine called Testament, and then soured on the industry and left the studio. MGM optioned a book of mine called Burnt Sienna for Pierce Brosnan when he was James Bond. And the development process takes so long that by the time they were getting to what they might have considered a good script, Pierce was no longer James Bond. And so MGM then thought, well, what do we care? And it's just fascinating the number of reasons for why a project does not move forward. In the bulk of these cases, once the deal was made, as one director producer said to me, now that you have signed the contract, we never want to hear from you again. On the other hand, I've had a handful of cases, I've had exceedingly good relationships, but they're very rare.
Well, my final two questions, I'll make this combined it. And I've heard in a different interview or interviews that your relationship with Stallone is more of a professional relationship, but there is interaction there, I guess, when a new project from the franchise was coming along. But also, when people mention your name, and I know it can be tough to self-reflect like this, how do you think your name and your works will be remembered?
Well, in the first case with Sylvester Sly, I have spoken to him on many, many, many occasions. When he was making Creed in Philadelphia, we talked. He was interested in noodling some ideas for a possible movie. Nothing ever happened with him, but it doesn't. The point is that he and I talked every weekend for, it's been a while in my memory, 7 weekends anyhow, maybe longer. And we spoke on the phone for an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours. And that was probably the longest time we've spoken. Over the years, we've spoken when Rambo 4 came out, he called me and we spoke for about 2 hours and he told me what he was trying to accomplish in the film, of Sam Peckinpah version of a Rambo film. And we have an excellent relationship, but I can't, my definition of a friendship is that I've been to someone's home, that I've had, I've shared a meal with them in a restaurant or wherever. And that's not the case with Sly. So I can't say that we're close in that way, but we have a respectful professional relationship and we have talked a lot. People often ask me what he's like. He's very smart and he's very funny. And he understands movie storytelling as well as anybody ever did. And beyond that, I'm fond of talking about Richard Crenna's opinion of Sly's acting. Richard, who's no longer with us, God bless him. Richard had a very long career from a child actor on, and he worked with everybody. And he told me that in his long career, there were only two actors. He was talking about male actors here, not female actors. Only two actors who knew what to do in front of a camera, as opposed to emoting or interiorizing the character and all that, but knew that there was a camera and you had to do something in front of it. And those two people were Steve McQueen and Sylvester Stallone. And both were masters of using props, are in Sly's case, still is, and the use of eyes, Sylvester's main technique, main skill, main absolute ability involves is using eyes rather than dialogue in order to communicate emotion. So I'm a big fan. I like him a lot. and we've had very serious, substantive conversations, not this sort of thing that I told him years ago. I said, Sly, I won't relate to you as an actor. I relate to you as an author, as a writer. So that's always the way we talk. And as far as we all die. And after we die, people forget us. So my only task in life is to find something to do day after day, in addition to my family, that makes me feel fulfilled. And that it happens to be writing. And I've been very lucky to have a successful career. Most authors, this is shocking, but it's true. Most authors earn about $6,000 a year. It is not something you want to go into if you think you're going to be rich and famous. And why anybody would want to be famous is a whole other problem. The task of writing is to find a way to feel at peace every day. It's a form of meditation. And I've been fortunate because people like to read, as it were, my meditations, my stories. I got into storytelling because I was raised in a very unhappy home and I slept under the bed while my mother and stepfather argued. And I told stories to myself and that stuck. And I eventually became still telling stories to myself. First Blood and Rambo are pretty much, I think, permanent. 50 years from now, somebody will know who Rambo was. It's really a hoot for me to be able to say that the miniseries of my book, The Brotherhood of the Rose, is the only miniseries ever broadcast after a Super Bowl. And it gives me great pleasure. There's a wonderful author named Jack Carr, C-A-R-R. He was a SEAL and who became a thriller political writer. Lots of action, but lots of interesting ideas about the way society works. And he regularly gives me, he was just number three this week on the New York Times bestseller list with a book called The Devil's Hand. And Jack, whom I know well, credits me The Brotherhood of the Rose as being a book that influenced him so much that he became a SEAL, as the characters in the book are, and became an author to try to do a modern version of what I'd done in The Brotherhood of the Rose. I have sort of embedded myself in thriller culture. I didn't go into it for the fame, certainly. It's not that I'm that famous, compared to Sylvester. I've been fortunate to earn a lot of money, but I never went into it for the money. You were talking earlier about something, the four truths of Buddha, the first one begins, life is suffering. And if we adjust to that, life is suffering. And how we then manage our lives with that understanding. And for some people in the United States, the suffering isn't very manifest, but for sure in other parts of the world, they understand that very clearly. If we understand that, then everything is in perspective. And what we do each day is to try to get along with dignity and fulfillment. And writing has been able to do that for me.
Well, if folks want to see some of David's projects, upcoming, previous, I know he's got Q&A up there. He's got everything you can think of. Also, his links for social media, davidmorrell.net. We will put a link to that as well. David, thank you so much for the time this morning.
Well, thank you. We talked about some important issues.
Yes, and I hope people can take away, like I said, as far as grief and just some of the issues we talked about. I'm hoping people can learn from them, but also try to apply it to their life in a good way.
Yeah, our task, as I see it, is to get up every morning and be better than we were the day before. And that's pretty darn hard to do.
But if you put the effort in, it can be done.
Hey there, Friday fans. We know how much you enjoy the movies. Enjoy grabbing your Friday merchandise.
in interacting with the Friday family, whether it be at conventions or during our particular watch-alongs. Well, when you're looking to get yourself masks, why not check out our friends over at Camp Blood Customs out of New York State and order your specific custom mask from any of the films. All orders are made specifically. Your needs and wants are. Make sure you find Camp Blood Customs on Facebook, Instagram, and all over social media and order yours today.
Hey, it's me, Bill Moseley, and you're listening to Crazy Train Radio. Ride that crazy train, and happy Halloween.